بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. We continue with the explanation of the creed by Al-Imam Al-Barbahari using the explanation of the noble Sheikh Saleh Al-Fawzan Hafizahullah Ta'ala. We are still covering the statement of the noble Imam Al-Imam Al-Barbahari. اعلموا أن الإسلام هو السنة والسنة هي الإسلام ولا يقوم أحدهما إلا بالآخر. The author, he stated, have knowledge that Islam is the Sunnah and the Sunnah is Islam. It does not stand without the other. And we covered in the last class that some of the ulama or the scholars have mentioned that what is meant by al-Islam is the testimony of La ilaha illallah, and what is meant by the Sunnah here is the testimony Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it's clear that there is no La ilaha illallah without Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and there is no Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam without La ilaha illallah. For Allah is the one who says, he doesn't come on his own, and he doesn't speak from his desires, making up legislation for himself. Rather, it is Allah who sent him and revealed to him the revelation. And at the same time, we cannot worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala properly, except with that which Allah has revealed to his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For we do not have a direct connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the aspect that we receive revelation from Allah so we know how to properly worship. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sent his messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, calling the people to that which is correct and teaching them that which is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and warning them against that which is incorrect and from that which is displeasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Sheikh had mentioned, as for the statement, was sunnatu hi al-Islam, the Sheikh says, لا فرق بينهما. إذا فسرنا السنة بالطريق فلا فرق بينهما أو فلا فرق بينها وبين الإسلام. The Sheikh says, as for the statement of Al-Imam Al-Barbahari, and the sunnah is Islam, he said, there's no difference between the two. And this is if we explain that the sunnah is the path. If we say that what is meant by the sunnah here, meaning the path, the religion of Allah, then there is no difference between it and between Islam. We find that the ulama of the past, they viewed being guided to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be a favor from Allah that is other than the favor of Islam. We have from the narration on the authority of Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma. He said, ما فرحت بشيء من الإسلام حشدت فرحا بأن قلبي لم يدخله شيء من هذه الأهواء. He stated that I have not become happy more than my happiness that nothing from these evil desires has entered into my heart. So he here, radiallahu anhu, is showing that being protected from the affairs of innovation is something else. It is from Islam, but it's another affair. It's from Islam, but it's another affair. Because a person can be guided to Islam. A person is not a Christian. A person is not a Jew. A person is not a fire worshiper. But then, as a Muslim, the person is not protected from innovation. So yes, he's on the religion of Islam, but he's not on the Sunnah. Meaning he has with him the evil desires from the affairs of Rahimahullah ta'ala, he stated, ما أدري أي النعمتين علي أعظم إذ أخرجني الله من الشرك إلى الإسلام وعصمني في الإسلام أن يكون لي فيه هوى. Abu Aliya, he stated, I do not know which of the two favors from Allah is more greater upon me. Whether it is the favor that Allah has removed me from shirk to Islam, that's one favor, or the favor that Allah has protected me in Islam, that I have with me any of the desires, meaning innovation. So you see how he mentioned two bounties. One favor, Allah removed him from shirk into Islam. So he's not a Christian, he's not a Jew, he's not a pagan, he's not an idol worship. He's a Muslim, he worships Allah alone. And then he mentions another favor, that while he is on the religion of Al-Islam, he's a monotheist, Allah protects him from falling into innovation. Al-Fudayl ibn Iyad, rahimahullah, he says, طُوبَى لِمَنْ مَاتَ عَلَى الْإِسْلَامِ وَالسُنَّةِ فَإِذَا كَانَ كَذَلِكَ فَيُكْثِرْ مِنْ قَوْلْ مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ. Al-Fudayl ibn Iyad, rahimahullah, may Allah have mercy upon him, he said, glad tidings for the one who dies upon Islam and the Sunnah. Mentioning two things. Meaning the person die as a Muslim, and on top of that, as a person who truly followed the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He wasn't upon innovation. He says, and if the matter is like that, then increase in the statement of MashaAllah, what Allah has willed. Ibn Awn, he stated, مَنْ مَاتَ عَلَى الْإِسْلَامِ وَالسُنَّةِ فَلَهُ بَشِيرٌ بِكُلِّ خَيْرٍ. Ibn Awn, he stated that whoever dies upon Islam and the Sunnah, then for him is the glad tidings of every good. It is mentioned that Al-Imam Al-Awza'i, rahimahullah ta'ala, he stated, رأيت رب العزة في المنام. I've seen the Lord of Might in a dream. And the scholars say that there is nothing preventing an individual that a person sees Allah in a dream, but not with the eyes of his head while he's awake. It's mentioned that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he's seen Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a dream, in the best manner. Ask someone what? Then no one can see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the ulama have mentioned that this is what the Sahaba are in agreement upon. So Al-Imam Al-Awza'i said, فَقَالَ لِي يَا عَبْدَ الرَّحْمَنِ أنت الذي تأمر بالمعروف وتنهى عن المنكر؟ He said, Oh, Abdul Rahman. And Abdul Rahman, this is the name of Al-Awza'i. He was one of the scholars of Sham. Sham, like the Palestine, Jordan, Syria area. That area is called Sham. So he said that Allah said to him, Oh, Abdul Rahman, you are the one who commands with the right and forbids the wrong. So Al-Imam Al-Awza'i said, قُلْ بِفَضْلِكْ يَا رَبْ He said, by your virtue, O my Lord, meaning by your virtue, I command the right and forbid the wrong. And then Al-Imam Abdul Rahman Al-Awza'i said, يَا رَبِّ أَمِتْنِي الْإِسْلَامِ O my Lord, cause me to die upon Islam. And then he said that Allah said, وَالسُنَّةِ In the Sunnah. Al-Imam Abdullah ibn Mubarak, Rahimahullah, and Abdullah ibn Mubarak is one of the great imams. Abdullah ibn Mubarak. Abdullah ibn Mubarak is one of the great imams of his time. When you read his biography, you will see that he was a Muslim who combined between the different acts of ibadah. He used to fast a lot, he used to pray a lot, he used to study a lot, teach a lot, give sadaqah a lot. Like the different acts of ibadah, he had a great portion of all of them. Abdullah ibn Mubarak, rahimahullah ta'ala, he stated, اِعْلَمْ أَخِي أَنَّ الْمَوْتَ الْيَوْمِ كِرَامَةٌ لِكُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ لَقِيَ اللَّهَ عَلَى السُّنَّةِ He said, have knowledge, my brother, that death today, dying today, is a matter of nobility for every Muslim who meets Allah upon this sunnah. So you see how the scholars of the past, they will mention Islam and then they will mention the sunnah separately, showing that being guided to Islam is one thing. And being guided to the sunnah, that's an added virtue and ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon the individual. Al-Imam Al-Marwudi, rahimahullah, he asked Al-Imam Ahmad, Man mata ala al-Islam, mata ala khayr? He asked Imam Ahmad, the one who dies upon Islam, has he died? فَقَالَ لَهُ Al-Imam Ahmad, اسكت. من مات على الإسلام والسنة مات على الخير كله. فإمام أحمد said to him, be quiet. Rather the one who dies upon Islam in the Sunnah, this is the one who dies upon all good. Because again, a person can be upon Islam and he's a Muslim. He's within the fold of Islam. But the person is not a follower of the Sunnah. Meaning, his aqeedah is different from the aqeedah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You understand? He is a Muslim. He has the origin of Islam with him. You'll find he prays five times a day. Fasts Ramadan. Pays the zakat. Makes the hajj. But then he has with him affairs of innovation. In his creed. He believes that Allah is everywhere. Right? You understand? So the person has the origin of Islam, into Islam. But the individual has been important innovation. But Imam Ahmed was told, he said to him, be quiet. You have fallen short. Rather, the one who dies upon Islam in the Sunnah, this is the one who has died upon all good. طلحة ابن عبيد الله البغدادي رحمه الله He said وافق ركوبي ركوب أحمد بن حنبل في السفينة فكان يطيل السقوط فإذا تكلم قال اللهم أمتنا على الإسلام والسنة الله طلحة ابن عبيد الله البغدادي He stated Me and Ahmed ibn Hanbal were riding on the boat at the same time. riding on the boat and the riding of Imam Ahmad were at the same time. And he said he used to be silent for long periods of time. This is the way the Prophet ﷺ, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's characteristics is described as full sum. And he used to be silent for long periods of time. The Prophet didn't just talk. Unless there was some benefit. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to be quiet for long periods of time. He'd be silent. And we find this is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because they know that from the affairs which cause a person to be thrown upon his face in the hellfire, the harvest of the tongue. Hasad al-Alsina, the harvest of the tongue. A lot of people will go to hell because of their tongue. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam understood this. And the scholars of Islam, they understood this and they understand it. So this is why you'll find them, they don't speak a lot. And when you do find them speaking, they speak with that which is of benefit for themselves and for others. So he mentioned that Imam Ahmad rahimahullah was quiet for long periods of time. فَإِذَا تَكَلَّفَ When he said, اللَّهُمَّ أَمِتْنَا عَلَى الْإِسْلَامِ سُنَّةً. Oh Allah, cause us to die upon Islam and the Sunnah. And it's mentioned that Al-Imam Ahmad rahimahullah used to say when he made dua, أَمَاتَنَا اللَّهُ عَلَى الْإِسْلَامِ وَالسُنَّةِ. May Allah cause us to die upon Islam and the Sunnah. Upon one day, an individual he mentioned in the presence of Al-Imam Ahmad, Alhamdulillah, alladhi hadana ila al-Islam. وقال الإمام أحمد والسنة. It was stated in the presence of Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah, all praise is due to Allah who guided us to Islam. And Imam Ahmad said, and the Sunnah. Abu Bakr ibn Ayyash, he stated, As-sunnatu fil Islam a'azzu min al-Islam fi sa'il al-adyan. He said that the sunnah in Islam is greater than Islam amongst the rest of the other religions, amongst the rest of the religions. I mean, being upon the sunnah in al-Islam, this is something that's greater than Islam amongst the rest of the religions. Showing the importance of the Sunnah. And the noble Shaykh Muhammad Asruddin al-Albani rahimahullah, he used to say, Alhamdulillah al-Islam wa Sunnah. All praise is due to Allah for Islam and the Sunnah. These are statements from the scholars. What do they base this upon? They base this upon the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, اِفْتَرَقَتْ الْيَهُودِ عَلَى إِحْدَى وَسَبْعِينَ فِرْقَةِ وَاِفْتَرَقَتِ النَّصَارَى عَلَى إِثْنَتَيْنِ وَسَبْعِينَ فِرْقَةِ وَسَتَفْتَرِقُ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ عَلَى 73 فِرْقَةٍ كُلُّهَا فِي النَّارِ إِلَّا وَاحِدَةٍ قَالُوا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ مَا هِيَ تِلْكَ الْفِرْقَةِ قال صلى الله عليه وسلم من كان على ما أنا عليه اليوم وأصحابي. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم he mentioned that the Jews they split into 71 groups and the Christians they split into 72 groups. And this nation was split into 73 groups. And he's talking about who now? Huh? The third category, this nation. Who's he talking about? This from us, the Muslims. Right, us, the Muslims. All of them in the hellfire, except for one. Now, he's a Muslim. So the companion said, which one are you talking about? He said, those who follow what me and my Sahaba are upon. So now you see the difference from being upon Islam and then being upon the Sunnah. These 73 groups, all of them are upon Islam, according to the correct position of the ulama, that these are the Muslims. They're not talking about disbelievers or apostate. He's talking about Muslims, people who are still within the fold of al-Islam. The Prophet mentioned that from the 73 groups, 72 of them in the hellfire. But it doesn't mean that they're going to go to the hellfire forever, because they're Muslims. And no Muslim will go into the hellfire forever. It's temporary. Any Muslim that goes to hell is for a temporary time, according to the degree of his sin and disobedience to Allah. The greater the disobedience, the longer the term the person spends in the hellfire. And you have the Muslims who will be brought out of the hellfire due to the intercession of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the intercession of the malaika and the intercession of the believers. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will bring out of the hellfire the one who has the least amount of faith in his heart. He'll bring him out of the hellfire because he's a Muslim. No Muslim will remain in the hellfire forever. And those who understand this narration to mean that these individuals, as the Prophet said, from the 72 groups will be in the hellfire forever, then they have misunderstood the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he mentioned that the 72 of the 73 will be in the hellfire, meaning these Muslims are Muslims who are upon innovation. They have within the origin of Islam, but they were not grounded upon the Sunnah, meaning they were not grounded upon the correct aqidah, the correct belief system. They were not grounded upon practicing the Sunnah and keeping away from the affairs of innovation. So because of their innovation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish them for that. And here's another side point. Not every deviant will go to hell, because Allah may forgive the individual. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لا يغفر أن يشرك به ويغفر ما دون ذلك لمن يشاء. That indeed Allah, He does not forgive that partners are associated with them, but He forgives what is other than that to whomsoever He wills. Innovation is other than shirk, meaning the innovation that doesn't put you outside of the fold of Islam. That's other than shirk. So the mubtadi', the deviant, the innovator, he's under the will of Allah. إن شاء عذبه وإن شاء غفر له. If Allah wills, Allah punishes. And if Allah wills, Allah will forgive him. So when the Prophet mentioned that the 72 groups are in the hellfire, it doesn't mean that every individual from that group will go to hell. Perhaps Allah will forgive the individual who was upon innovation. But the shahid of the point here is that the Prophet mentioned that in general, the groups of deviant, the groups of innovation will be in the hellfire. And the only ones who will be saved, right, from the hellfire, are those who are upon where he and his companions were upon. Meaning those who are upon the Sunnah. And here's a side point. It doesn't mean that no one who is upon the Sunnah will go to hell. He may not go to hell for innovation because he didn't practice innovation, but he may go to hell for zina, for committing fornication or adultery. He's a person of the Sunnah. He has with him the correct aqidah. He's not upon no innovation, but he was a sinner. Meaning he had with him other sins which did not include innovation. He was a person on the Sunnah. He followed the methodology of the Salaf, but he was a thief. He followed the Sahaba in Aqidah. He worshipped with the worship of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba. He had no innovation with him, but yet he's a thief. Yet he was a liar. Yet he was a fornicator or an adulterer. That person can go to hell for those crimes. So one should not understand that because he doesn't have innovation, gives him a pass to go to while he is committing other sins. Those other sins can be a cause for that person to go to the hellfire. People will be punished for zina, for adultery and fornication. People will be punished for stealing and lying. In the hellfire, what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إِيَّاكُمْ وَالْكَذِبْ فَإِنَّ الْكَذِبَ يَهْدِي إِلَى الْفُجُورِ. وَإِنَّ الْفُجُورَ يَهْدِي إِلَى النَّارِ. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, be aware of lying, because lying leads to corruption, and corruption leads to what? The hellfire. Some people have the mentality that because they are upon the sunnah, because a person is a Sunni Muslim, he follows the way of the Salaf, that this gives them the right to commit of the crime. You have individuals who attribute themselves to the methodology of the Salaf. They're selling drugs, lying, cheating the Muslims, committing fornication and adultery, and other sins from the major sins. You being upon the methodology of the Salaf and the affairs of Aqidah and Ibadah does not give you the license. And it does not allow, it's not an allowance for you to commit other sins that are other than innovation and shirk. See, the people, they have become corrupted. And the reality is, we don't just follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the affairs of Aqidah and in the affairs of Ibadah and that's it. No. We also follow him in the affairs of character. And we also follow him in the affairs of the Mu'amala, the business affairs, and the dealings. As Sheikh Muhammad ibn Saleh al-Saymin, he mentioned that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he came to correct four things. Al-Aqidah, Al-Ibadah, Al-Akhlaq, Wal-Mu'amala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned, or Aslan, Sheikh Muhammad ibn Saleh al-Uthaymeen mentioned that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to correct four things. Number one, the creed, the Aqidah. And number two, the Ibadah. These are the most important four. The Aqidah and the Ibadah. But it doesn't mean that the other two are not important. And it's sad, subhanAllah alhamdulillah. The people who follow the sunnah, meaning their understanding is the understanding of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they have no innovation. And these should be the best of people in relation to character. Because the people of the sunnah, they have the knowledge. Ahlul sunnah wal jama'ah, they're the most knowledgeable of the Muslims of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No one is more knowledgeable of the Quran and the Sunnah, the Ahl al-Sunnah wal Jama'ah. No one. Why? Because they follow the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They understand the way the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So being that this is the case, that means that their character should be the best because they have the most knowledge. But unfortunately, some people, this is not the case. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us for our shortcomings. I mean, so it's very important that we understand that being a Sunni Muslim upon the methodology of the Salaf, from the Sunnah wal Jama'ah, does not give you a license to commit sins that are other than shirk and innovation. Because a person is still subjected to the punishment of Allah. And even a prescribed punishment in this life, if a person is living in a land where the Islamic law is being established. As an example, there was a companion by the name of Abdullah. His nickname was Himar. He used to make Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam laugh. However, at the time, he had difficulties with drinking khamr. He used to drink intoxicated. Every time he drank, he was brought, the Prophet would command that he be beef. The Prophet didn't give him a license to say, no, he's on the sunnah, let him go. No, he was beef. A companion, radiallahu anhu, he was beat for the crime of drinking. So he wasn't given a license to drink, he was beat. Because that is a violation of Islam. It's not from the affairs of Aqidah. It has nothing to do with innovation. That's a sin, from the major sin. So he was beat, he was punished. But at the same time, the person who's on the sunnah, who's a sinner, is better than the person who was on innovation and he's not a sinner. Look what the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was being beat. Abdullah, that is, he was being beat. So one of the companions said, مَا أَكْثَرَ يُؤْتَى بِهِ لَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ. He's been brought so many times for this crime of drinking. May the curse of Allah be upon him. The Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, لَا تَلْعَنْهُ فَإِنَّهُ يُحِبُّ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ. Allah Akbar. The Prophet said, don't curse him. For indeed he loves Allah and his messenger. So although he had the weakness of drinking khamr, at the same time, his heart was sound with love of Allah and the love of the messenger of Allah. He wasn't a deviant, he wasn't an innovator. But now look at Dhul Khuwaysa. Dhul Khuwaysa was described as being a man, he had a big beard, big prostration mark on his head. And you can see the traces of sujood on his body part. Person who was a man of worship. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam distributed some spoils of war, he gave to some people and didn't give. So look at Dhul Khuwaysa. What did he say? He said, this division or the face of Allah wasn't intended by this type of division. Ya Muhammad, i'dal. O Muhammad, be just. SubhanAllah. Here's this man of ibadah. Awli. Never known to be beat for drinking or anything. But he makes the statement, O Muhammad, be just. SubhanAllah. That's a crime in itself. For him to accuse the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam of not being just. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من يعدل إلم أعدل? Who's going to be just if I'm not just? And the one who's above the heavens, trust me. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, سيخرج من ضد هذا أناس وأقوام يقرؤون القرآن ولا يجاوز حناجره. It is going to come from the loins or the lineage or from the progeny of this individual of people who recite the Quran but it doesn't go past their collarbone. يَمْرُكُونَ مِنَ الْإِسْلَامِ كَمَا يَمْرُكُ السَّهْمُ مِنَ الرَّمِيَّةِ. They will go out of Islam or go through Islam like the arrow shoots out of the bow and goes through the tank. Dhul Khuwaysa, he is known as the father of the Khawarij. SubhanAllah. So now look at this man, a man who was known or seen to be a person of ibadah. Not known to drink or anything, or ever punished for any crime. So look at him, and look what the Prophet said about Abdullah Himar. Who's better, Dhul Khuwaysa or Abdullah? Abdullah. Although he was drinking, he was still upon the sunnah. He had a shortcoming, he had a deficiency, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam punished him for that. But at the same time, his aqidah was sound. So the one who's Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, who has sinned other than innovation, he's better than the deviant who doesn't have those sins. Because the sin of innovation is greater than the major sin and the lesser form of sin. The Salafi mentioned that the sins are of five levels. The greatest level of sin, الشرك الأكبر, the great shirk, the major shirk, five levels of sin. Allah Allah, I only say what I know, what I've heard from the scholar. No, that's a hadith maybe he's talking about. The seven destructive sins.
Oh, yeah, no,
yeah. Ayatollah. So we're talking about the seven levels of sin. Those seven destructive sins are within these levels. The highest level, the greatest level, is al-shirk al-akbar, the major shirk. That's the highest level of sin. Under that, al-shirk al-aslam, the lesser form of shirk. Under that, al-bid'ah, innovation. Under that, al-kaba'ir, the major sin. And under that, al-saghair, the lesser form of sin. So innovation is worse than the major sin. Why is that? As Sufyan, rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned, al-bid'atu ahabbu ila iblis min al-ma'asiyah. The innovation is more beloved to Iblis, meaning the shaitan, then acted disobedient. So he was asked, well, why is that? Why is the affair of innovation more beloved, Iblis, than the acts of disobedience? He stated, Al-ma'asi yutab minha. The acts of disobedience, meaning like a person, he drinks khamr, a person, he steals, a person, he cheats the people, and other than that, when he commits these sins, he knows that he's doing wrong. So this individual, he repents. More so than bid'ah. La yutab minha. As for the one who is doing innovation, he does not see that he's doing something wrong. But as a result of that, what? The person who's stealing, the person who's cheating, the person who is lying, the person who's committing adultery and fornication, from other Muslims, does he know or does she know that what has been done is wrong, yes or no? Yes, we all know, alhamdulillah, this is because these matters are known in the religion by necessity. That stealing is haram and cheating is haram. These things are known. Widespread. Scholars in the common folk know that these matters are haram, right? So now if a Muslim, he falls into fornication or adultery, as an example, does he feel good about it?
No,
he doesn't. He's sleeping with this woman, he shouldn't be sleeping with her. She's not his wife. Or the woman is sleeping with a man, she shouldn't be sleeping with him. That's not her husband. There's some guilt there. What may come as a result of the guilt? The person makes hope. Now, the deviant, when he celebrates the Prophet's birthday, or celebrates the 15th of Shaban, how does he feel after he finishes? He feels good. So that means he doesn't do what? He doesn't make tawbah. Why is he going to make tawbah from something good? That's the point. That's why innovation is worth in sense. Because when a person is doing innovation, he thinks that what he's doing is ibadah, worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So as a result of that, it's rare that you find that an innovator repents. But the person who's doing sin knows that they're wrong. They know. You may see your brother smoking cigarettes. He says, astaghfirullah, ya akhi. What he says? Make dua for me. How many times do you hear that? Person, go to the store. The brothers are selling beer and pork in the store and selling lotto. You go to them and say, akhi, you need to fear Allah and stop selling these things. You know how many times, you know what they say? Make dua for me, akhi, barakallah. So many times I've heard this. But the point is, they know what they're doing is wrong. The guilt is there. Now, if you go to a Sufi masjid, when you reach outside your head, as you get out of there, you're disturbing the worship. Because they believe that what they are doing is correct. So when the person believes that what he is doing is correct, and that he's worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that person is not going to make tawbah. Let me ask you a question. You just prayed with us right now, Salat al-Maghrib, right? In congregation. How you feel about that? MashaAllah. Are you going to make tawbah later on so Allah forgive you for praying Maghrib in the masjid? Huh? You see the point? How you feel, how staunch you feel about that? That's how the innovators feel about their innovation. Why should I make tawbah? I'm doing something that's correct. I know what I'm doing. This is how the innovators, they believe that what they're doing is correct. This is worship, it's ibadah. They're not going to repent. And it is haram for a person to repent from doing good. Anyway. You understand? Why is it haram to repent from doing good? It's haram. Why? Now, first, let's look at repentance. What is repentance? Okay, that's one thing. So now, if you make repentance from doing good, you're saying that what you did of good was actually wrong. Another thing, repentance is regret. You feel sorry for what you did, so you feel sorry for doing something good. And you're not supposed to feel sorry for doing good. Repentance is having the firm resolve that you're never going to do it again. You understand? So you can't repent from doing the act of obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, meaning the aqidah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the ibadah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These matters are the most important affair, along with his character and how he dealt with the people. You cannot exclude those two affairs. You cannot. Sheikh Uthaymeen, he was asked, when does a person leave from the realm of al-firqa tunajiyah? I mean, when a person is no longer considered from Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And then he mentioned that when a person is in opposition to Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and in the affairs of ibadah, the person has left the realm of being a Sunni Muslim. He's still a Muslim, but he's upon innovation. However, if the person's aqidah is sound and the person's worship is sound, but he's in opposition in the affair of his character and his dealings, he's still within the realm of Ahl Sunnah wa Jama'ah. However, he has a deficiency with them. Deficient. So who loves to be described as being deficient? So we, the people of the Sunnah, just as we have great concern for our aqidah and our ibadah, we also have to have concern for our character and how we deal with the people. We should be aware of being the cause of running the people away from the Sunnah. As the noble Shaykh, Shaykh Rabi'a Hafidullah Ta'ala, he mentioned that the origin is to bring the people in, run the people out of the Sunnah. The people in the Sunnah, for all of them to practice the Sunnah. But unfortunately, people, behavior, they chase the people away from the Sunnah. Understanding of Islam. Although the person may have the sound knowledge, how to believe and how to worship, it's not terrible for the people they don't take from the person. This is a crime. This is a crime. The scholars, they have warned against this affair. You have to be in character and good gifts.
Naam.
So it's important that along with our aqidah and our ibadah being sound, our mannerism and our dealing with the people, they have to be sound. And if we do not deal with the people in a manner that is appropriate, then it will be a cause of chasing the people away. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he would send the Sahaba to go and give da'wah to the people, he would say, Bashiru wa la tunafiru. Yassiru wa la tu'assiru. Give glad tidings to the people. Don't chase them away. Make things easy upon them. Don't make things difficult. This is from the methodology of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in giving da'wah. So when we call the people, meaning the Muslims, through the sunnah, because Muslims are also in need of da'wah. They are in need of da'wah to be upon the sunnah. They are upon Islam already. Alhamdulillah. Now we need to call those Muslims who are not practicing the sunnah. We need to call them to the sunnah. But it has to be done with gentleness and kindness, using beautiful words, using wisdom. And those who need to be dealt with in a stern manner, then we deal with those individuals in a stern manner. But that's not the origin. The origin is a risk or lean, gentleness and leniency. So the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as mentioned by Sheikh Rabi'a Hafidhullah, والسنه هي طريق النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ومنهجه واخلاقه فمن لم ياتي بهذه السنه فهو مبتدع ضال لم ياتي بالاسلام وقد يكون كثير ممن يتعمد هذه المخالفة كافرا أو منافقا. أعوذ بالله من كل ذلك. The Sunnah is the path of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and his methodology and his character. So whoever does not come with the Sunnah, then this individual is disguised. He has not come with Islam, meaning he is not practicing Islam the way he's supposed to be practicing Islam. Because in reality, although the Sunnah is another mercy from Allah, it's still from Islam. You understand? That's why Imam Al-Barbahari, he said, لَا يَقُومُ أَحَدَهُمَا إِلَّا بِآخَرٍ. One does not stand without the other. They both go together. And separate them. Be upon Islam, but I'm not going to be upon the Sunnah. Well, but I'm not going to be. My Aqeedah is going to be correct. Other aspects of Islam, I'm going to leave off. No, no, no. Both of them, they go together. So the Sheikh has mentioned this. And it's possible that many from amongst, Waikum Salaam, that many from amongst the people who intentionally opposition the Sunnah is not this individual, constantly opposing, constantly opposing that Sunnah is following the command of the Messenger of Allah that can be become a power. Or a person is constantly in opposition. Well, he doesn't believe in Islam, personally. So the Sheikh Salih Fawzan, Hafidhu Allah Ta'ala, he mentioned, لا يقوم الإسلام إلا بالسنة ولا تقوم السنة إلا بالإسلام. الذي يدعي الإسلام ولا يعمل بالسنة أي طريقة الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم ليس بمسلم، والذي يعلم السنة ولا يسلم لله ليس بمسلم، وإن عرف السنة فلا بد من الجمع بينهما. الشيخ حفظه الله تعالى يقول that Islam does not stand without the Sunnah, nor does the Sunnah stand without Islam. So the one who claims Islam, but he does not work with the Sunnah, means the path of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's not a Muslim. And this can be understood in relation to the one who rejects the Sunnah. Like those individuals who call themselves the Qur'aniyun. They say that they only need the Quran. They don't need the Sunnah. They claim Islam. They say that they are Muslim, but they refuse to work by the Sunnah. They say they don't need the Sunnah. We don't need the Hadith. We only need the Quran. These individuals are not Muslim. Because they're rejecting the Sunnah. How a person is going to practice the Quran without the Sunnah? So this statement that we don't need the Sunnah, we need the Quran, this statement is a statement of apostasy. Because you can't pray without the Sunnah. The details of the Salah are in the Ahadith. The details of paying the Zakat are in the Ahadith. The details of fasting, the details of Hajj are in the Ahadith. So this could be understood from this manner. When the Shaykh says a person is not a Muslim, meaning he rejects the Sunnah. But he claims to be a Muslim. No. You have to follow the Sunnah. And the more the person is in opposition to the Sunnah, the more deficiency the person has in his Islam. And then he says, and whoever knows the Sunnah, the person may understand and knows the Sunnah, but the person has not submitted to Allah, doesn't worship Allah alone, doesn't submit to the commandments of Allah, and this individual is not a Muslim, even though he knows the Sunnah. And I was speaking to one of the imams here in New York City. I had visited Rikers Island to give the khutbah there to the Muslims on Rikers Island.
After the khutbah, me and the imam, the chaplain of that building, we went into his office and began to talk about some affairs. And then he mentioned to me that he went to our conference, so he was at a gathering, where there was a disbeliever there who appeared to be grounded in the science of hadith. And this individual was defending the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. He was defending the hadith. He said, I think, was he a Muslim? He said, no, the man was a Kafir. I said, you should say the man was a disbeliever. He was not a Muslim. He said, but he knew Arabic, and he was defending the hadith and showing how that Islam is the only religion who has preserved the teachings of their prophet, sallallahu alaihi. So here's an example of a person who knows the sunnah, but he hasn't what? He hasn't submitted to Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He hasn't submitted to Allah. He knows the sunnah. He's able to say that the science of hadith is an infallible science. Meaning from the aspect of it protected the sunnah. Allah used the scholars of hadith to protect the sunnah. Where they're able to distinguish between what's authentically reported on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and what's fabricated. That's how we know what narrations are a lie upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because of the science of hadith. We are the only religion on the face of the earth that has this science. The religion of Islam is known as Dinul Isnad. The religion of the Isnad, the chain of knowledge. We have it. So we trace back this individual, said this individual, all the way back to the Prophet. So we investigate. Who is this? Who is this? Who? You understand? Who applies that? Besides us? No. And this is what this castle was explaining. Well, the Shaykh says, وَالَّذِي يَعْلَمُ السُّنَّةِ ولا يسلم الله ليس بمسلم وإن عرف السنة فلا بد من الجمع بينهما. So the one who knows the Sunnah, but he has not submitted to Allah, he's not a Muslim. Even if he knows the Sunnah, it is a must that the person combine between both affairs. قال المؤلف رحمه الله فمن السنة لزوم الجماعة فمن رغب غير الجماعة وفارقها فقد خلع رزقة الإسلام من عنقه وكان ضالا مذلا. The author may Allah have mercy upon him, he stated. We're moving on to the second point now. From the Sunnah is holding on to the jama'ah. And whoever desires other than the jama'ah and separates from the jama'ah, then he has removed the yoke of Islam from his neck. And he is astray, leading others astray. Shaykh Saleh Khawzan, hafidhahullah ta'ala, he mentioned, after the statement, فَمِنَ السُّنَّةِ فِي لُزُومُ الْجَمَعَةِ ما دام الأمر كذلك أن الإسلام هو السنة والسنة هي الإسلام فالسنة أنواع فمن السنة لزوم الجماعة أي لزوم جماعة المسلمين والمراد بالجماعة هنا جماعة المسلمين الذين على الحق أما الجماعة التي ليست على الحق فهذه لا تسمى الجماعة الحقيقية كل جماعة اجتمعت على ضلالة أو على منهج مخالف للإسلام أو على طريقة مخالفة للإسلام فلا تسمى الجماعة الحقيقية المطلوبة الممدوحة فالجماعة المرادة هنا هم أهل الحق وليس من لازم ذلك أن يكونوا كثيرين بل لو كان واحدا على الحق فإنه يسمى جماعة فالجماعة هي من كان على الحق قل أهله أو كفروا فتلزموا من كان على الحق ولا تخالف الجماعة التي على الحق بل تكون معهم على الحق فمن فاق الجماعة فسيأتي بيانه. Sheikh Saleh Fawzan, Hafizullah Ta'ala, he states, as long as the matter is like that, that Islam is the Sunnah and the Sunnah is Islam, then we need to understand that there are different categories of the Sunnah, different aspects of the Sunnah. From the Sunnah is holding on to the Jama'ah, meaning holding on to the Jama'ah of the Muslim. And what is intended by the Jama'ah here is the Jama'ah of the Muslims, those who are upon the truth. This is very important. When we hear the word Jama'ah, we should understand meaning those who are on the truth, not any group. This group, Jama'ah to so-and-so, Jama'ah to so-and-so, Jama'ah to so-and-so. Just because a group is named Jama'ah, it doesn't mean that that group is upon the truth. How do we know whether the group is upon the truth or not? Whether the group and its practices and its creed are in accordance to the Sunnah of the understanding of the Sahaba. This is what we use to judge all of the affairs, all statements, all actions, all creeds. The Book of Allah, the Sunnah of the Prophet, the understanding of the Sahaba. Every matter of the religion that we see from the people, we measure their actions, their statements, or their creed up to these three things. If it agrees, we accept it. If it disagrees, we reject it. The Shaykh mentioned, as for the Jama'ah, meaning the group, which are not upon the truth, these groups are not to be named the Jama'ah in reality. These groups are not the real Jama'ah. Every group, every Jama'ah that is gathered upon misguided, or upon a methodology that opposes Islam, or upon a methodology, or upon a path that is in opposition to Islam, then this group is not to be named the real Jama'ah, which is requested from the people, and the Jama'ah that is praiseworthy. You have the Ikhwani, Jama'at al-Ikhwani al-Muslimin, the group of the Muslim Brotherhood, or even Jama'at al-Tabligh, Barakallahu Fikum. These groups that you'll find mentioned along with their name, Jama'at group. However, when you study that which is listed, look at the Ikhwani as an example. Muslim Brotherhood, they have principles with them that they have for their group. As an example, a principle that they call the Golden Principle. The Golden Principle, they call it. This principle states, لَتَعَاوَنُوا فِيمَا اتَّفَقْنَا عَلَيْهِ وَنَعْبُرْ بَعْضُنَا بَعْضَ فِيمَا اخْتَلَفْنَا. We work together on what we agree upon, and whatever we disagree upon, we pardon one another. That's the principle. Just like that, unrestricted. That's misguided. This principle means you can't command the right to forbid the wrong. This is why you find amongst the Muslim Brotherhood, Shiites, Sufis, people who say they're Ahlus Sunnah, even Christians. Amongst the Muslim Brotherhood, at times they had Christians amongst their group. Because they say, we work together on what we agree upon, we pardon one another, or we disagree upon. From the misguidings of the Ikhwan, they have Muslims that they ask for the leader of the group. This is not permissible. The bay'ah is for the ruler, not for a leader of the group. So you'll have as an example the Ikhwanis that are here in New York. Those who follow that methodology, and they have the magic and the imam, they're from the Ikhwanis, each imam is asking for the members of the congregation to give them bay'ah. And I say this to you, brothers, there, and wallahi, I mean, the day you hear me asking y'all to give me bay'ah, kick me out of here. I'm serious. Okay, Shaykh? You gotta get this quick. The day I say you have to give me bay'ah, run me out of here. Because you know that I've lost my mind and I'm following the path of deviance. The imam is a masjid, you don't give the imam bay'ah. The bay'ah is for the Muslim ruler. Right? Whether it's the Khalifa who's over the entire Muslim Ummah or the Muslim ruler who's over the country. Ask for a leader of a group. That person is not given bay'ah. So look at the understanding. They say, well, we have to have an emir over our group. As the Prophet he mentioned, that whenever the people are traveling, that they should have an emir over them. So if there is an emir for traveling, then indeed we need an emir for when we are not traveling. Number one, even if that's the case, the people who are traveling make a point on their emir, they don't give the emir bay'ah. And the reason for the emir being pointed amongst the traveling group, this is the purpose of having the affairs and order, chaos and argumentation amongst the people. As an example, say we are traveling, and we say, oh yeah, Sheikh Hassan is going to be the emir amongst us. So now, we're differing in relation to, should we stop and eat at a place and sleep or drive 3 or 4 more hours and then after that stop to eat. The emir is going to be the one who's going to say, okay, no, let's continue to drive. So that stops the differing and the bickering amongst the brothers over what we should do in relation to the travels. But we don't give the bay'ah to Sheikh Hassan. You understand? He's just the emir over us at the time of traveling. And once the travel is over, that title is removed from him. That position is removed from him. So they cannot make qiyas upon this narration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to having an emir over their group who they give bay'ah. And they say that for this emir, a sam'a wa ta'a. That he is to be all heard and obeyed. As if the emir is the Muslim ruler. This is what the Ikhwani, their group. Now, this is a group. But this group is upon falsehood. Just look at the Tablighi. They have errors with them. From their errors, they do not have any concern for the Aqidah. As I used to be with them. I'm from experience. I'm picking up things on them. Speaking from what I learned from them, when I was with them, and that which was is in their book, that which was taught by their elders. They hold that the teaching of Aqidah causes separation between the Muslims. That's misguidance in itself. That's the main thing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam focused upon, is the Aqidah. They don't teach Aqidah because it causes separation between the Muslims. They even said not to study Bukhari and Muslim. Wallahi, I was at an ijtima one time. This is when I was with them. This ijtima was in Boston. Back in 1996, maybe. Yeah, right? I think in 1996. Yeah, I think it was around that. I became Muslim in 1994. And I went with them around 1996. Went to this big ijtima in Boston. They had a big tent. It had to be about 2,000 people. And when we was there, in the morning, at the Fajr, we hear the bayan from the elders. And then after that, we memorized the last 10 surahs of the Quran, which was Amma, and then we eat, we rest, get up for dhuhr,
get some more stories from the houses, make some dhikr, get your lunch, sleep, wake up for asr, more stories. After that, maghrib, isha, the big sheikh come, the big elders, they come, they don't call them sheikhs, the elders, they come and stories, all day is stories. I'm serious. All day is stories. No teaching of Aqidah. And if they do, or when they do, read from Riyadh al-Salihin, they only read from certain chapters of Riyadh al-Salihin. Understand that. They say, yeah, they encourage to read Riyadh al-Salihin. It's one of the books. Yeah, not the whole Riyadh al-Salihin. You know why? Because in Riyadh al-Salihin, there's a chapter warning against innovation.
Wow.
You didn't know that? You will never find them reading that chapter. What you'll find them reading? The virtues of Salah, the virtues of Siyam, the virtues of Zakat. It's forgotten. That's why they have the book, Fada'il al-A'mal. Right? Or they call it Tabligh al-Nisa. That book has fabricated hadith throughout the book. Fabricated hadith. In that book, there should be in that book. Wallah. Going to the graves, asking people in the graves. It's in the book. But yet, you find with this group, Jama'ah. And this is why we're telling the brothers here, they are not allowed to speak here in the masjid. Some brothers didn't understand. They think it's something personal. Nothing personal against them as far as no one from amongst them stole any money from the masjid. Or disfigured the masjid, wrote on something in the masjid, or stole books from the masjid. Or they're dirtying up the carpet in the masjid. Or they took money from me personally. Or said something about my family. Nothing personal. As far as those affairs. Rather, it's a matter of the religion. Don't let them speak in the masjid. Whoever's here, because they come. Wallahi, they came one night. I was sitting right over there. I don't think they knew that I was the imam there. And I didn't say anything. I was waiting for one of them to go ahead and give the bayan. But somebody from here called them to come. Wallahi, somebody here called them to come here. Because they gathered together, and they looked around, and they kept looking over at me. I just put my head down and kept doing what I was doing. I was going to see how far they was going to take it. Then two of them went out, and three of them went out here, then one of them stayed. And then they was talking, and then they came back in and kept looking. So they called somebody on the phone. And they kept turning around looking back. So I don't know if they was describing me, saying, yeah, there's somebody here or whatever. Because the people know that I'm against them. And if I'm here, they can't talk. And if I'm not here, they're not allowed to talk here. Because they spread deviation, even if that's not their intention. You find from amongst them, people, they're sincere. What life? You find from amongst the people, they're sincere. They want good. However, as Abdullah bin Mas'ud, he mentioned, كَمْ مِنْ مُرِيدًا لِلْخَيْرِ لَنْ يُصِيبًا. How many times a person wanted to do good, but he never attained it? It's not enough for a person to want to do good. You have to want to do good and then know what's good so that you can do it. Do not let the Tablighi speak here. I'm telling you, they're going to take the people away from the correct Aqidah. They're going to take the people to do stuff that was not done by the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Going out. What they say, Fisa Bidillah, 40 days, khuruj, 6 months khuruj, making jawla. This was not done by the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. A person will accept Islam right now. Wallahi, akhi, your brothers, he accepts Islam. They will take him out on jawla to give bayan. And akhi, I'm telling you, I know what I'm talking about. I'm not making up stuff on these individuals. A person just accepted Islam. What is he going to speak about? They say this is the Prophet's sin. Sahaba out. Yes, the Prophet did send Sahaba out to give dawah, but he's the knowledgeable ones from the Sahaba out. He didn't send anyone out to give dawah. The Tablighis, they do the opposite. They didn't send anybody out. I'm telling you, I went out. I didn't know nothing. They pushed me up to give bayan. Don't know nothing about Islam. They put me in front of the people. Never say anything. This is a mistake. This is Allah's deen. You can't say anything. Anybody just can't get up. Start speaking in front of the people. The person, when he speaks, he has to speak with knowledge. He can't just speak based upon my experience and learn the religion.
sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, weak. That's a connector. You understand that point? The commandment of Iqra, the read came before the commandment of giving da'wah. But the reason, their methodology is the opposite. They put anyone up to go and give da'wah to get that to go and go and listen to that. That knowledge should cause more harm than good. Just because a group is named the Jama'ah, it doesn't mean that they are the Jama'ah. The Jama'ah, as Abdullah ibn Mas'ud stated, مَا وَافَقَ الْحَقِّ إِن كُنْتَ وَحْدَكَ. The Jama'ah is what agrees with the truth, even if you're by yourself. You can be in a place, nothing has been over here today. You're the only one who's on the Sunnah. You're the Jama'ah. So the Shaykh mentioned, what is intended by the Jama'ah, the people of the truth, it is not a must that those people are Allah's people, Allah's number, or the other people. Or Allah's people. And Islam don't judge things by the majority, the number. It's by the quality, not the quantity. Right? And at times, the people of the truth, they may be the majority. But that's not the deciding factor. The deciding factor is what the people are upon. Look at this hadith where the Prophet mentioned. And I've seen a prophet who will come on Yom Kiyamah with two people with him, or one, and then I've seen a prophet who comes with nobody. Meaning that these prophets, they call people, but only two people accepted the call. Only one person accepted the call. And for the other one, no one accepted the call.
It was a what? I thought it was a majority.
Huh? A minority. But were they upon the truth, or the people who opposed them?
Yeah.
They were upon the truth. The Prophet said a lot of the Prophet, whoever that Prophet was, and his two followers, they were upon the truth, and his people who opposed them were upon the truth. The people who were in opposition were the majority. So do we judge the truth based upon the majority? No, it was upon call, the practice. That prophet who comes with one individual, him and his follower were upon the truth. They were the Islam. Those who were in opposition were upon the side, although they were the majority. Right? The prophet who comes with the fellowship is the prophet who comes with no follower. Meaning no one responded to his call. He wasn't on the truth. He was on the truth. The individuals who opposed him, all of them, they were the ones who were upon the site. So we do not check the number. Rather, it is the quality, essence of what the person is upon. He mentioned, Hafidhu Allah Ta'ala, so it is not a must that they are the majority, or they are many in number. Rather, even if it is one person who is upon the truth, then that person himself is the Jama'ah. So the Jama'ah, it is those who are upon the truth, even if the people are small in number or they are large amount. So hold on to those who are upon the truth and do not oppose the Jama'ah, which is upon the truth. Rather, be with them upon the truth. And whoever opposes the Jama'ah, then the clarity of what the individual situation is will come. So here, Sheikh Saleh Fawzan, Hafidhullah Ta'ala, is clarifying that the Jama'ah is what agrees with the truth, even if a person is by himself. That person is the Jama'ah. Not because of the person's name, or how the person looks, or where the person is from, how big his beard is, it's because he is upon the truth. Right? As the Prophet ﷺ mentioned, in أَنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَى أَمْوَالِهِ وَأَجْسَامِهِ ولكن الله ينظر إلى قلوبكم وأعمالكم. الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم سننجين الله إذا سمع لك يغرب نوعي لك شباري والله لك شهار إن لك شعاش. Not a person's wealth that makes him upon the truth is not a person's appearance that makes him upon the truth. His name, his geographic location. What makes the person upon the truth? That his heart is sincere and free from being connected to anything or anyone besides Allah, and that the actions are in accordance to the meditation. That's why Allah looks at the heart. Allah looks at your heart to see if you are sincere or not, and He looks at your actions to see if your actions are correct or not, whatever those actions may be. This is what establishes that this person is on the truth. Your money is not going to help you. Those who think that because they have a lot of material possessions, or that they have a lot of money, that this means that they are upon the truth, then this person has the misconceptions of Pharaoh. Pharaoh, he thought that he was the one who had the truth with him because of what? Because of what he owned in Egypt. These are my palaces. Underneath some rivers are flowing. I have this. I have that. Musa alayhi salam was poor. He didn't have anything. So Pharaoh looked at himself as being the one who was superior, because of what he possessed in the worldly affairs. And he looked at Musa as being inferior. But the reality is that Musa was the one who was the superior one, and Pharaoh was the one who was inferior. Why was Musa superior? Because he had the truth with him. It had nothing to do with money.
Whatever is incorrect is for myself. Subhanaka lahum bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.